or a piece of riverbank? A bit of soil. Which is more valuable, a human life or that bit of dirt? Well, I mean, what could they say? Of course, obviously they had to answer a human life. So, if a human life is more important, more valuable than a piece of riverbank, why are you going to take so many lives, damage so many lives over a bit of dirt? Chastened, they packed up their weapons and went home. This is an important story, it's a powerful story. Time and time again, people are fighting over property, over power. Armies are launched against armies. Armies are launched against civilian populations, against countries. In the world at the present time, there are several wars, several armed conflicts going on. Why? What for? What's the price? The price is the destruction of many human lives, the destruction of a great deal of property. Was the destruction of human lives. When you take life, now remember the first precept, many of you have taken the precepts today, Panati Pata, to abstain from killing. And it means what it says. It means abstaining from killing. Any living creature. Well, some living creatures we will say are more important than others. For the most part, we'll think that human beings are more important than animals, and certainly more important than insects. But all these living creatures basically want to live, and to live out their lives in tolerable comfort and happiness. And when you threaten with violence, you take away that comfort and happiness, and you bring into their minds fear. And with fear comes hatred and aversion. And that hatred and aversion poisons our world. Not only poisons our minds, it poisons the world. It poisons everyone. And the damage is colossal. The harm is immeasurable. We're used now, because we have the media to bring us videos and pictures. We're used to seeing shots of war, and we know that many of those men and women who go out to fight come back in boxes. Go back in boxes. Their bodies. And everyone makes a big fuss and puts a flag over them and says how brave they were and so on and so forth. And no doubt they were. But now they're dead. And nothing anyone can do will bring them back. You must remember this. When you take life, you take something that can never be restored. If you steal someone's property, you can give it back. Or at least you can give them the value back. But if you take someone's life, that's it. And you cut off the potential that life had. That life had the potential to become an enlightened being. Human beings, every one of us, have that potential to rid ourselves of greed, hatred, and delusion and become enlightened beings. When you take that life, you cut off that possibility, at least for now. And you spread the poison of violence. Now I'm well aware that people will say that in certain circumstances there is no alternative. But actually there is. There's always an alternative. You have really to learn to think in the long term. The big picture. not the short term and the little picture. Not just what's good for me, it's going to make me sort of feel a bit better for 5 minutes. You have to look deeper and further than that. And realize that when there is violence, and violence is answered with violence, then it goes on and on. The Buddha himself said, hating doesn't cease by more hating. It ceases, it stops by not hating. Violence is the same. It stops when you stop being violent. That's when it stops. When you find another way. Now that reception I went to was supposed to celebrate the contribution that the Buddhist community makes to the United Kingdom. And I feel, I think, that the Buddhist community has and does make a great contribution to this country. And it would be even more if more people practiced Buddhism, and even more if those who do did it even better, kept the precepts even more carefully than they do already. The contribution that we make then is an alternative to the way of defilement, the way of killing, the way of violence. It's a contribution which can lift people up and can show them that there is another approach to all the problems of the world. Now, this month, in 2 weeks' time, we will celebrate Asalaha Puja, shortly under 2 weeks, strictly speaking. But at the Forest Hermitage, we will have our celebration on July the 17th. The Buddha's first sermon, the Dhammacakka Pavattana Sutta. Dhammacakka Pavattana Sutta means the setting rolling the wheel of Dhamma, the wheel of truth. A very important discourse, not only because it was the first time the Buddha had attempted to make known what he understood when he became the Buddha, but also because of its contents. And what it contains, I can remind you, is first of all the middle way, the principle of the middle way. And then the Buddha spoke about the Four Noble Truths. And the fourth of those noble truths is the Noble Eightfold Path. And here you have essential Buddhism, the essential message. And it's relatively simple, very profound, and I won't deny difficult to put into practice. But there it is, a great gift from the Buddha. This first sermon, the Dhammacakka Pavattana Sutta, the setting in motion, the wheel of time. The middle way. For many people, practicing Buddhism is very common to me, that it's a bit like walking a tightrope. And some giants to say that when he was teaching, he was simply saying to some people, go right a bit, go right a bit. And to someone else, go left a bit, go left a bit. Well, all of this actually is we're practicing doing this, so we're trying to sort of trim our practice and keep our balance. And then the Four Noble Truths. The first, this life, this experience that we have is dukkha. Dukkha means unsatisfactory, it means it's experienced as suffering. Second noble truth, the cause of dukkha. What's the cause of dukkha? Tanha, kye tanha. Desire, thirst, wanting, ambition. The third noble truth, this dukkha can be stopped. The kye tanha can be overcome. And the fourth noble truth, the way to do it, the Noble Eightfold Path. There's no Noble Eightfold Path, it's well set out, tend to think of it in a different order to the one the Buddha first taught. When the Buddha first taught in this sermon, he spoke about right understanding and right thought or mental intent first. And then he went on to write Speech, Right Action, and Right Livelihood. That's the segment of the part concerned with virtue and morality. And then comes right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. And these three make up the practice of meditation. And in a moment we'll sit and meditate for a few minutes. And when we do, remember, you have to make an effort and be mindful and to concentrate your mind on being mindful. But later in his life, the Buddha spoke of the path as Sila Samadhi Panya, morality, meditation, and wisdom. And that's perhaps easiest to remember. And of course, it's practical. You have to have that foundation in virtue and morality. And when you build on that, then you can train yourself, train your mind, and eventually training your mind, practicing meditation, developing mindfulness and awareness, you cultivate insight that leads to wisdom. So I won't go on any longer now, but I hope that some of the things I've said today will have some meaning for you.